Hey guys, so I'm Ryan Corbett. I work as a data scientist and also some front-end development at a consulting firm, and big one here in the area. And so I'm just going to talk a little bit about topic modeling and also what you can do it within Python. There are some, say from the start, there are some great topic modeling options out there in other languages. What I'll call out is Mallet. It's in Java. I'd highly recommend that one, but if, you know, like me, if you want to work in Python, this is a great option. So, I didn't write Gensim, I'm just sort of praising it. I'll say that from the start. It's created by this amazing guy. I'll name drop him in a second here, but I'm just a very happy user, so I'm just kind of,
woo!
So topic models, what are they? They're the statistical models. Often trying to get at sort of latent things, things you can't measure directly, but you can infer them by looking at how words are distributed over documents. So a corpus, if you're familiar with that word, is usually referring to a body of text, and it's usually split up into documents. A document is just an abstract object. It could be anything. It could be a tweet. It could be a report. It could be something in between, you know? So a document is just sort of a coherent collection of text. And what this image is going to represent, just sort of give you this idea of what a topic model is trying to get at. It's looking at the distribution of words over documents and trying to get at sort of these latent constructs. I'll try to keep it brief about sort of the mathematical. I don't want to go into detail about the mathematical underpinnings of topic models because this isn't really DC statistics. This is DC Python. So let's kind of gloss over the math, a lot of the math. You can look it up in your own time. But I want to get straight to the Python. But I will cover briefly what the major topic models are that are out there. A major one is latent semantic indexing. This was really popular in the 90s. And it's the basic idea is to take all of your documents and create a big term document matrix by looking at how words occur and counting up occurrences. And then you can use some pretty fancy linear algebra, something called singular value decomposition. Again, you can look that up. It's a little dense, but if you devote your time, you can eventually sort of get an intuitive understanding of it. But essentially, what you're trying to do is reduce the number of dimensions of this big matrix so you can get at sort of the underlying dimensions. After that sort of went out of vogue, LDA really came into vogue. In the 2000s and now even up to today. So LDA is what people are usually referring to when they talk about topic modeling nowadays. And it's kind of a probabilistic extension of LSI / LSA. And it helps to think of this as constructs generating words over documents. And it's this idea that a document can be composed of multiple topics. And it's a distribution, a probability distribution over those topics. And then topics themselves can be thought of as distributions over words. And so that's what this is getting at over here. It's this idea that a topic is gene, DNA, genetic. These are all words and associated numbers, real values that give their sort of place in the probability distribution for that topic. And it gets really, there are a lot of cool things coming out, like even more complex stuff. One I'll call out is called Pachinko allocation. And just, it's kind of an extension. It builds upon this by saying you can, look at like how topics correlate among themselves. And you can look at sort of the hierarchy of topics. Again, this can get pretty complex, the math and statistics. But I do want to sort of call it out because this is probably going to come, become more popular. As you know, it's going to sort of overtake LDA. So the take-home points here are that documents can be thought of as sort of bag of words in vector space. And by vector space, I just mean you count up words and create a vector of numbers that represent how those words occur, how many times those words occur.
Oh no.
Okay, and then you can transform or reduce this vector space using linear algebra. And these transformations or models can reveal hidden patterns sort of underneath all of the variation on the surface. And then the way that you train these models is you do some pretty sophisticated stuff by sampling things in a very specific way. And one method is called Gibbs sampling. You can look it up. It can be pretty memory intensive, though, and that's what I want you to sort of take home from this point, is that something like Gibbs sampling might require you to bring the whole corpus into memory. And if you think about it, if your corpus is gigantic, then that's a non-starter. So there basically have become more popular different ways of doing this, ways where you don't need, where you can stream in documents rather than pulling everything into memory at once. So what's Gensim? It's a really great package, Python package, created by Radim Rederich, and I think he's an amazing guy. He's created this amazing resource. I would encourage you to check it out. And it's, you know, completely open source and free. You can go on GitHub, you can be a contributor. But today I really want to give you a feel for how it works and what it can do. What's really cool about it is that it's really designed for speed and for memory independence. Because these are big challenges when you're trying to create big topic models over huge corpora. This is a real challenge. And so it's really designed from first principles to be memory independent and to be fast. He uses a lot of cool stuff under the hood, like really highly optimized C and Fortran and like Scikit and Blaz libraries and stuff. He's really done due diligence in this area, like really done a lot of cool stuff under the hood to make it fast and memory independent. So what do you do to get started? You just need a list of strings, really. Those are your documents. And again, for example's sake, I'm putting it here, but these things do not need to reside in memory. They can be on disk, you know, like one document per line. And as you'll see, that's really kind of how you're motivated. That's sort of like how you're encouraged to work when you work with this package. So what do you do? So you can take a few sort of first basic steps to sort of clean some of the text and tokenize it. And sort of that's the crucial point, is that you want to take just a raw string and figure out where the word boundaries are. And, you know, there's some sophisticated ways that you can determine that, like where exactly there are the word boundaries. That's not as simple as a question as you might think, especially as you start talking about other languages other than English. So this is all sort of up to you. This is sort of where you really pick up the work. You have to think about how you want to tokenize and clean things and filter them. So there are other ways. You can filter out what are called stop words. And these are like function words like a, the, to, in. These are like just kind of just semantically empty terms that really are just sort of the skeleton of the English language. And they aren't really serving any semantic purpose. Usually people filter them out. And you can do some other filtering. You can filter out what are called hapax legomena. These are very rare terms. And you usually don't want to put them in your model because they do just wreak havoc and they don't really contribute much to the sort of the intuitive understanding of the model because they're just so rare. So, as you can see, you've done some cleaning up and you've got your docs ready. So you want to do what's called a bag of words model. And this is, again, get back to this idea of a vector representation. And why is it called bag of words? It's called bag of words because it fundamentally has no regard for order. So you might kind of scoff at that and think that's crazy, right? Because order is everything when two people are talking and when humans consume language. But for the purposes of these types of models, for simplicity's sake, all the words are just sort of pulled in and order is eliminated. And you do some filtering, but then the idea is that they're all just jumbled together and that the order no longer contributes. So, what's the first thing you do once you've got these sort of tokenized texts? You create what's called a dictionary object, and what that's going to do is it's going to map your actual strings, the words, to integer IDs. And this is going to help sort of internally for the package to keep track of things and sort of reduce memory load and keeps things efficient in general, and then serve as sort of just a reference. And so then you use a method on this dictionary object called doc2bow, that's just bag of words. You're basically, again, what that's going to be doing is it's going to just be going through the documents and counting things up. It's just counting things up. So this is the first document, and these first integers are just the IDs, and the second integer is the count for that word. And you can persist this to disk, which is convenient. And so after you've done, so actually, let me, as an aside, let me say that, again, getting back to this idea of being memory independent, you can use, through the magic of Python, use generators. If you aren't aware what generators are, I would encourage you to very quickly get up to speed with what they are, because they're incredibly important. Generators?
PBR?
What they are.
PBR?
Oh, no.
What they are. So unlike a regular function, it won't return, it will, after a single call, it will actually sort of, it'll keep its place and remember where it left off, so that you can, so in this case, it's pulling in lines from a text file, which resides on disk, one at a time, so it doesn't need to pull in the whole corpus at once. It can just go line by line, pulling them in and doing the processing. And here it's doing that, doing the processing for the dictionary object. And then here you can create like a class if you want to, again, sort of iterate, use the generator functionality, iterate over these lines of text, and you don't need to pull everything into memory, which is very awesome if you think about it, because a lot of times you're going to run into a situation where you just have a huge corpus and you just simply don't have enough RAM to handle it. So once you've done that, you want to do what's called, train. But train, I don't know if train is the exact right word, and that's why I sort of put it in scare quotes there. But it's this idea that you are just doing a sort of transformation on the matrix. And this one in particular, it's called TFIDF. It stands for Term Frequency Inverse Document Frequency. And what it's going to do is it's going to go over the whole corpus, and it's going to look at document frequencies. So it's going to look at, for each word, how many documents is it appearing in? So is it common in the sense that it appears over a lot of documents, or is it very rare and it appears in just sort of a sliver of documents? So is it a rare or common word? It's getting at that idea. And the rare words are going to be more information rich, and so therefore they're going to be upweighted. And so that's the idea, that's sort of the basic idea behind TFIDF, is that you want to upweight words that have more information, that provide more information to the model. So, that previous step, what you've done, is you created a model. So that's how Gensim works. You have to first create a model, and then you have to apply that model to your corpus. So here, in this step, that's what you need to do. You take the TF-IDF model, and you apply it to that corpus. And it has to be in the same feature space, because otherwise the transformation wouldn't make sense. You would have to refer to word IDs which don't exist. And so you have to make sure you sort of keep straight what feature space you're using when you're sort of passing these things around. And so the idea is that you no longer have these integers from before. You now have real values. And they can be, as they are here, they can be normalized. And the idea is that, again, that the rare words are sort of being upweighted. So, moving on to LSI, like we talked about before, latent semantic indexing. Glossing over the math, the idea is that you're doing dimensionality reduction. So your matrix consists of like tons of dimensions. You have a dimension for every word, every document. So what you're trying to do is you're trying to reduce that space down. So, and you choose that, this parameter right here, number of topics, 2. And so basically that whole space gets shrunken down. And so every document now becomes sort of passed in that space. And so then in this step right here, when you're printing out the documents, it's giving an indication. So the 0 and the 1 are the topics. And these numbers here are giving an indication of how much that document is along that dimension. And again, sort of for convenience, you can persist this to disk and like bring it back in when you want. And what's pretty cool feature is you can fold in new documents. That's sort of how it's built, is you can sort of update the model, the underlying model. With this sort of online training. And Gensim's really built around this idea of online training. Even down at sort of the algorithmic level, the implementation of the algorithms. So moving on to LDA. LDA is going to be what people probably mean when they mention a topic modeling algorithm. It's the most popular right now. And what's really cool about it is it allows you to look at how words represent a topic. So topics are thought of as probability distributions over words. And so this is an example of doing it over, I think Wikipedia. Yeah, this particular one. I'll show mine in a moment, but you can start to see some semantic structure. So this one's about like astronomy, this one's about like aviation, et cetera, et cetera. Again, sort of it's this online parameter estimation technique. So if you guys are interested in the math, I would encourage you to check out that paper. What's really cool is you can do similarity queries. So again, when you're casting things into this vector space, everything becomes mathematical, so everything becomes much more sort of comparable. So a lot of search engines will work this. They'll work this way. So if you've ever worked with Solr or Elasticsearch, one of those types of things, they're going to be using sort of this type of technique, along with other stuff, to tell you when you enter a query which documents are most relevant to your query. So the idea is that you can take your own just homemade query, whatever you want, and you can cast it into that vector space. And then once you've done that, you can compare it to an index, which is composed of a vector space you've already created, to pull out the most relevant documents to your query. So if you think about it, that's pretty cool, right? So if you, the query doesn't even necessarily have to share any words, which is pretty cool about LSA. When you do this dimensionality reduction with LSA/LSI, it really gets at sort of the underlying things that make a topic a topic. So the query here was human-computer interactions, and it brings up results here, which actually don't even have necessarily all of those words, but if you were to read it, you would really get, you would get an intuitive sense that makes sense, that this is a very relevant document. So now I just want to mention very quickly just a few things I've done with this. So I was doing working on a machine learning project for class, and we were working with an anonymized data set for personality research, and we had a bunch of social media posts people had written, and they were interested in detecting neuroticism. So automatically sort of determining, predicting whether somebody would get a neuroticism diagnosis, like professionally, just by looking at the words and all the features of the text that they in their social media posts. So it was kind of an interesting. It was hard. It's very difficult. A lot of the teams like just couldn't do very well because it's just baseline is just a very difficult problem. There's only so, you know, if you think about it, there's probably only so much signal out there for you to soak up. So, you try your best. And one of the features that I tried in a machine learning model is a 20-topic LDA model, because I wanted to get at sort of this idea of, like, are neurotic people sort of talking about certain things more? But I don't know, like, a priori, like, what those things are. Like, do they just talk about being, you know, homesick more? Do they just like bring up certain topics more just by virtue of being, you know, neurotic? And so like a few of these things here, like nap, hurt, heading, you know, some of the other ones are like a little happier.
So,
you know, Saturday, what's up? You know, another one's like, day, work, tired, home.
Best dinner.
Bored, snow.
I think those were all.
Yeah, no, I'm
worried. These are just examples.
So, this actually isn't, like, it isn't an amazing example of the topic model because the documents themselves aren't, like, very informed. They aren't super, like, coherent themselves because they're just social media posts. So, there isn't a lot of signal necessarily under there to detect. If you were running a topic model on, say, Wikipedia, like I showed a moment ago, there is a lot of signal because things are just organized. You know, it's Wikipedia. It's organized. But it's interesting what you can sort of pull out from all the noise of just a, you know, huge amount of social media posts.
You want it, man.
And then this is something I did just before this meetup, actually. I did this afternoon when I was putting this presentation together. I wanted to show how you could scrape news articles, but you could scrape only, you could filter out the ones that are only sort of relevant to a query that you have in mind. And so this little piece of code here is just meant to show, you know, like using something like Beautiful Soup and NLTK, you know, can you like scrape all of the headlines off of, say, CNN Health, and then using what I call a gold standard query, like fetch only the relevant data that's relevant to what you're interested in. So the gold query here I'm saying here is Ebola. It's in the news right now. So Ebola, strain, quarantine, spread, disease, contagious. Those are all just words I just thought of. I could imagine myself like, oh, like if I'm a like news reporter or something and I want to aggregate all the articles about this topic, you know, then I would just craft my own query. I would scrape a bunch of sites, pull in all the articles, and then transform this query into this vector space and then run it against an index and pull out the most relevant articles. So the articles here that are most relevant, who's who in the Ebola outbreak, tobacco plant may be key to Ebola drugs, Sandy Helperin was diagnosed with early stage Alzheimer's. So that's actually an indication, again, of how this is working. So I have a few medical terms here, like disease and, you know, diagnosis, I think it's down here, sick, ill, and it's really sort of getting at this sort of underlying dimension of sort of like medical whatever, and then like it's using that to detect these types of things, and that's why it gets boosted up as a relevant document for that query. So, that's all I pretty much have to say. If you guys have any questions, you can feel free to ask. Yeah.
Going to do a multi-word feature extraction like 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue or William Jefferson Clinton.
So, yeah, you're talking about like multigram. So, like, whereas a single word would be like a unigram, you're asking like you want to treat that whole phrase as a single entity in the model?
I didn't know I needed to. It's just something you'd... 1600 would be different than 600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
Yeah, you can absolutely do that. So these are called bigrams, trigrams. The problem is once you start doing that is that the feature space gets huge because you're creating bigrams and trigrams for every conceivable, you know, combination of words in the corpus. But if you a priori have like sort of a set of trigrams or bigrams you're really interested in, yeah, you can definitely like enter them into the model. Yeah.
Just to follow up, another thing you might try is running some named entity recognition first and then sort of feeding that in going forward. Anyway, two related questions though. I've heard that this has an implementation of the word to vec from Google. Have you played with that at all?
Yeah, I've played with it just a little bit. It does. A word to vec from Google. It's like this really popular tool that came out recently. Lets you create, these neural network models, and you can bring in massive amounts of text, and it casts it into this, finite dimensional space. Yeah, like it has a pretty awesome implementation. If you read some of his blog posts, you'll see that he did an incredible amount of due diligence to like make it really fast. Like he does a lot of stuff under the hood, like implementing like Cython and Fortran and C and like all these things I mentioned before. He just does a lot of that stuff. If you read his blog posts, and he documents everything to make it really fast.
So what has your experience been in runtime?
It's been really good. I have no complaints. I would say that there might be a small degradation in quality in certain respects when using the online training implementation, but I don't know, it's like almost imperceptible. Like I wouldn't necessarily say that's true. I just maybe sometimes. So like if you use something like Mallet, which uses like maybe a traditional like Gibbs sampling approach for parameter estimation, then you might find that your results are a little different. But overall, I would say it's I've been very happy. Yeah.
So how would you compare Gensim to like NLTK?
So NLTK doesn't have a lot of this sort of specialized functionality around topic modeling and vector space modeling. NLTK, I think, is more broad in the NLP world. It does allows you to do a broader array of things at the expense of not having these special vector space and topic model stuff.
Okay.
I love NLTK. I use it for a lot of stuff. I love the WordNet implementation, if you've ever used WordNet. If you don't know what WordNet is, if you're interested in NLP, I encourage you to check that out.
There are some things that you can do with NLTK that you can't do with Gensim.
Yeah, absolutely. Gensim's not, I don't think Gensim's pitched as like an NLP library per se.
Okay.
It's because NLP is such a broad...
It's more topic modeling.
It's more specialized to
right.
Vector space / topic modeling.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
One of the challenges with anything like Twitter, for example, is just your strings are so short that you can't do very much in terms of sentiment analysis or anything like that. It's either positive or negative, and any more nuance kind of gets a little lost. And there's been stuff that I've seen coming out of the UK with like really good Twitter sentiment analysis, but does Gensim offer anything that's really good on like a shorter 140 character string, like any kind of models or anything out of the box? Or
like specifically geared toward
not so much Twitter, but just
geared toward shorter.
Yeah.
I think I wouldn't say it has anything geared toward shorter stuff per se. I think the models really help you get at some underlying dimensions, so that when you are faced with such little information as a tweet. Even a single word would be a giveaway, would sort of be a gateway into that sort of underlying vector space. So I don't think it has anything geared toward like short text per se. But yeah.
So
yeah.
You mentioned Pachinko allocations. So that has overtaken LDA as like state of the art methodology.
I think probably right now it would be considered more advanced. It's a little more bleeding edge, and a little more academic. LDA, I think, has sort of moved out of being like discussed among academics and more is like entering the mainstream.
Uh-huh.
Just like LSI was.
Uh-huh.
So. Pachinko, I think, is like it's really interesting. It's more advanced. I think most of the time when people are thinking of top modeling, they probably want something that LDA. They're going to be satisfied whatever LDA provides.
Okay.
Whereas Pachinko is, you know, probably more advanced. If you want to look at how topics correlate, you would definitely want to look into it. And Gensim has something implemented called a hierarchical Dirichlet process. It's getting at a similar idea, this idea of looking at how topics form a hierarchy, as opposed to just, you know, sort of a flat structure of how topics appear.
And do you know what year did Panchinko come out? Like relatively recently?
So the way that I think, so the way that a lot of these models and algorithms sort of percolate into the mainstream is that, you know, academics will discuss them for like 5 or more years, like, you know, at least, and then finally, like, you know, people like implement them in these popular packages. And
do you know when the first paper came out
for Pachinko allocation? I think probably in mid 2000s or mid to late. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. LDA. The LDA paper came out 2003, I believe.
2003. Yeah, by Jordan, right?
By Bly and all them.
Yeah.
At Princeton. Yeah. And then Pachinko probably followed up about 3 or 4 years later, something like that.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Yeah. These things take a while. You know, academics will discuss them for a while.
Yeah.
They can be pretty. You know, the math and the statistics can be pretty dense.
Yeah.
For somebody who's not, you know, initiated
right.
to that world. But I think the underlying sort of intuitive idea is very simple, is that, you know, documents are consist of multiple topics in a probability distribution, and topics consist of words in a probability distribution. I think that's a pretty simple idea, and that really gives you the sort of core.
So if you were to apply topic modeling, like in practice, like say, you know, on the job or whatever, so would you go with LDA, or
yeah, I would probably go with LDA.
Okay.
Yeah,
why
just
is that?
I'd probably just consider it the state of the art.
Okay, because it's more refined. Like, it's been around for a while.
It's been, yeah, exactly. It's been discussed and refined among academics. It's been widely accepted. It's been implemented in various ways. I would say it's probably just considered probably the state of the art right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
But Jinko is still like in development. And
You know, it's these things. Yeah, I don't know if I can't like sort of make that judgment, but
based on your experience.
Yeah, based on my experience. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Can you give us some examples of applications? Like, I was working with a guy a few years ago on LSI techniques for like Python docs. Oh, this document, if you're reading it, probably if you're interested in that, you might want to check out these other 3 documents that we have over here. Just like LSI everything.
Right.
Doesn't sound like it's a great match for like prediction engines. But what applications do you see for this that would be sort of common use cases?
I would say common use cases would be just organization. So a lot of organization.
More than just like search.
More than just search, yeah. I think just raw organization. So a lot of government agencies and organizations, they have like huge like document stores. Yeah, they're not even, sometimes not even databases. Like they're just like.
SharePoint.
huge stores of documents, and they're interested in the underlying structure. They want to know how these things naturally group. You know, obviously nobody has the time to put eyeballs on all those documents, so, you know, this is sort of a quick and interesting way of getting at that. And as I guess thinking of some other applications, you know, obviously search is really important, like being able to determine relevance. Like, you know, this is about vector space modeling too, you know, so being able to, you know, refine your own vector space and then run your own refined specialized queries on that, and being able to just sort of set up your own environment where you can do your own queries and determine relevance, and, you know, I think that's really important for a lot of organizations to be able to do. Is to be able to pull in documents and determine relevance to some interest, you know.
People who like this regulation might like this regulation.
Yeah. yeah. Exactly. You know, it's all about like sort of getting at sort of the underlying constructs. You know, like what's hidden underneath, you know, like all this surface variation. A lot of the time clients won't even know what they're looking for. I mean, and that's sort of the appeal. It's supposed to be the appeal and sort of the drawback of topic modeling is that, you know, you don't even know what you want, but you know you want structure. That's about it. You know you want to find something, but you don't know what you're going to find. And so that's actually, you know, that brings up a whole host of its own problems. Like, you have to interpret the topic model. You know, it's not going to just give you, it's not going to hand you on a silver platter like a really nice, beautiful answer. You know, it's gonna it's going to give you a bunch of these parameter estimates along with words, you know, and you have to read each one of the words, and you have to sort of interpret them. You have to interpret, and often the results aren't going to be super clear, you know, and you have to maybe play around with, you know, the parameters you enter in the model, like how many topics you want, for instance. So, you know, there's a definitely a key sort of human element of interpretation still that you bring to the topic modeling task. So.
Anybody else?
I'd love to get a copy of the slides.
Sure. Yeah, I'll send them out after the talk.
Excellent. Thanks.
Yeah. And again, this is just meant to sort of hopefully sort of give you a feel for what it's trying to do and how it works. And again, if you have some text data and you really want to sort of mine it and get at like what's in here, then this is sort of a great way to start.
Yeah. So related to the form question, do proper nouns present a challenge? So it can be earth, lowercase, earth, uppercase, and two vastly different topics.
Right. Yeah. So this sort of gets at another problem called word sense disambiguation, which is this idea that a surface form of a word will hide a huge amount of variation in senses. So, like the word get, you can use the word get in all different types of ways. Get's a very common word, but you can use it to mean to obtain something, or you know, to propel some, to, you know, you can use it like in all sorts of different ways, and these are referred to as senses. WordNet helps you get at sort of sense, this idea of senses. Proper nouns, somebody mentioned named entity recognition. You could run some named entity recognition before, and this named entity recognition is going to try to pull out these, you know, usually most of the time they're going to be proper nouns. This idea of objects that exist in the real world and that refer to something. So you could do a pre-processing step using something like NLTK, for instance. But there are a lot of great packages out there that allow you to do that. There's the Java Stanford Core NLP package, which I would also highly recommend. That's probably one of the most highly regarded packages out there for doing these types of NLP tasks. So you could definitely do it as a pre-processing step and sort of isolate these items, and sort of you could tag them in a certain way, you know, to differentiate them, and that would be a good sort of a way to target that problem.